draw PV by NT versus P. PV by NT versus P for real gas and also for ideal gas. Draw PV by NT versus P for real gas and for ideal gas. PV by NT versus P. First consider an ideal gas. For an ideal gas, PV equal to nRT or PV by NT equal to R. For an ideal gas, PV by NT equal to R. So for an ideal gas, PV by NT is constant or not? So for an ideal gas, PV by NT is constant. It does not depend on P. This is for ideal gas. But for a real gas, PV by NT is not constant. For a real gas, PV by NT is not constant. For a real gas, the graph is like this. I have shown three graphs for three different temperatures, T1, T2, T3. T1 is greater than T2, greater than T3. I have drawn three graphs for three different temperatures, T1, T2 and T3. Okay. So, this is the variation. It is not constant. PV by NT is not constant. It varies. So, from this presentation, we can conclude that at higher temperature, see, at higher temperature, this graph is close to the graph for ideal gas. So, we can conclude that at higher temperature and smaller pressure, see this pressure is small. So at higher temperature and at small pressure, real gas exhibits behavior close to that of ideal gas. Okay, real gas behavior is close to ideal gas behavior at higher temperature and smaller pressure. Okay, if you consider high pressure, then it's going in this direction. That means there will be too much variation. There will be too much variation at high pressure. So at low pressure and at high temperature, T1 is greater than T2, greater than T3. Okay, so write this point. This is a very important point. From the graph we conclude that at higher temperature and at smaller pressure, real gas behavior is close to that of an ideal gas. Draw P versus V at constant temperature. Draw P versus V at constant temperature for real gas and for ideal gas. draw P versus V at constant temperature for real gas and for ideal gas. First, for ideal gas, all of you know this graph. P versus V at constant temperature. This is the graph. Boyle's law graph, very important. This is for ideal gas. But for real gas, it is different. It is like this. So this is for ideal gas and this is for real gas. Draw V versus T at constant pressure. This is at constant temperature. Draw V versus T at constant pressure for real gas and for ideal gas. What will be the graph for ideal gas? A straight line passing through origin. Okay, remember the complete description. A straight line passing through origin. Okay, do not just remember straight line, then you will be on wrong foot. Remember that it is a straight line that passes through the origin. If this straight line does not pass through the origin, then V will not be proportional to T. Okay, V is proportional to T. At constant pressure, V is proportional to T. That happens only when the graph passes through the origin. If the graph does not pass through the origin, if it is like this, then for that particular graph, V is not proportional to T. Okay, so when pressure is constant, V is proportional to T, and that graph should pass through the origin. Okay. If question is asked, a graph is shown like this, and if question is asked, is V proportional to T? Answer is no. For this graph, it is not. This is for ideal gas. Ideal gas. For a real gas, it is like this. There is slight deviation. This is for ideal gas, and this is for real gas. This is for, real gas. Right here, pressure constant. Okay. Next question is, find an expression, for the pressure of an ideal gas. Find an expression for the pressure of an ideal gas. Pressure of an ideal gas is given by this expression. Pressure of an ideal gas is given by this expression, P equal to 1 by 3 rho c square, where rho is the density, of gas, and c is the RMS speed of its molecules. So P equal to 1 by 3 rho c square is a very important formula. You have to remember this. Pressure equal to 1 by 3 rho c square. Its derivation is important. Those who are in CBSE board, derivation is important. And derivation is little big. Okay, but it comes in your school exam. Okay, now I derive P equal to 1 by 3 rho c square. I'll consider a vessel, a container, a cubical, consider a cubical container. L, this is also L. Okay. Inside this, there are a lot of molecules. Inside this, there are a lot of molecules. M equal to mass of each molecule. M equal to mass of each molecule, and n, small n, equal to number of molecules per unit volume, per unit volume, and capital N equal to total number of molecules present inside the container total number of molecules present inside the container is capital N. N equal to number of molecules per unit volume. M equal to mass of each molecule. How can you find the pressure? Suggest some ways to find the pressure. Obviously, it's quite correct that pressure equal to force by area. So that means we'll have to focus on finding force. Then force divided by area will be pressure. How can you find force? Using the basic definition of force. What is the basic definition of force? Rate of change of momentum. Okay? Most fundamental definition of force, that force equal to rate of change of momentum. So in order to find pressure, we'll have to find force. Then in order to find force, we'll consider the rate of change of momentum. Rate of change of momentum of what?
Molecules.
Rate of change of momentum of a molecule. Why will the momentum of a molecule change? Due to collision with the wall of the container. Okay, so what is the origin of pressure? Origin of pressure is actually the heating of molecules. The molecules are heating the wall. That produces pressure. Molecules are heating the wall of the container. So a molecule is hitting this wall and rebounding from it. If it hits the wall with a velocity u, and since this is the molecule of an ideal gas, there is no change of velocity. So it will hit the wall with a velocity u, and it will rebound from the wall with same velocity u. There is no, all the collisions are perfectly elastic. So what is the change in momentum of the molecule due to one collision?
2 mu.
Okay? You know change in momentum is a vector quantity. Change in momentum equal to final momentum minus initial momentum. What is the final momentum? Minus mu. If you consider this direction as minus. Minus mu. What is the initial momentum? Plus mu. So what is the change? Minus mu minus mu. Final minus initial. What is the final momentum? Minus mu. What is the initial momentum? Mu. What is the change? Final minus initial. Minus mu equal to minus 2 mu. So due to each collision, the momentum of the molecule changes by 2 mu. Okay? But you have to find, in order to find force, you have to find the rate of change of momentum. That means there is a time factor. There is a time factor. Due to one collision, the momentum is changing by 2 mu. How many such collisions are occurring in 1 second? How will you calculate that? Because you have to find the rate of change of momentum. Change of momentum due to one collision is 2 mu. Rate how many such collisions are occurring in 1 second. This is the wall. The molecule hits it, rebounds from it, goes to the opposite wall, again undergoes one collision, again rebounds and comes back to it. So hitting, going back, rebounding, going to the opposite wall, getting reflected from that and coming back to it. So what time is elapsed before the second collision occurs? L plus L. What is the total distance traveled by the molecule? L plus L, 2L. And the velocity is unchanged. So time elapsed is 2L by U. L plus L by U. So time interval between successive collision is 2L by U. Okay, so we'll find the rate of change of momentum. Calculation is little complicated because of the fact that molecules are having different velocities and the velocities are all in different directions. One molecule is going in this direction, another is going in this direction, another is going in this direction. This molecule is having a velocity C1, this is having C2, this is having C3. All the things are very random. Okay, so that's why we'll have to use average method. Okay, the reason is all the velocities are different, all the directions are different, there is no order, there is no discipline. Okay, when you consider the molecules of an ideal gas. Okay, so consider a molecule, its velocity is C1. Okay, consider another molecule, its velocity is C2. Consider this molecule, its velocity is C3. Okay, resolve C1. Let us consider only this molecule, then we'll include all the other molecules by using some average method. Okay, resolve this into 3 components. The components are U1, V1, U1 in this direction, now this is X direction, U1, V1, this is V1, and W1. Okay, so since U1, V1, W1 are the components of C1, we can write C1 square equal to U1 square plus V1 square plus W1 square. Okay, so we are considering a particular, we are considering molecule number 1. For molecule number 1, this is for molecule number 1. Okay. Let us consider the force exerted on the right wall, of the container. Okay? On the right wall of the container. Change in momentum. So remember, we are considering molecule number 1. All our discussions are related to molecule number 1. Change in momentum of the molecule due to one collision with the right wall. Due to one collision with the right wall equal to minus mu1 minus mu1 equal to minus 2mu1. Why is it minus? Initial momentum. This is initial momentum. mu1, what is the final momentum? This is final. This is initial. Final means after collision. Initial means before collision. So what is the change in momentum? Final minus initial. Final is minus mu1. Minus mu1 equal to minus 2mu1. Okay? Then. Now. Rate of change of momentum. Okay? Time interval between two successive collision, time interval between two successive collision with the same two successive collision with the same means right wall. Time interval between two successive collisions with the same right wall. What is the time interval? It hits this wall, rebounds from it, goes to the opposite wall, again rebounds from it and comes back to the first wall. So the total distance traveled by the molecule is 2L. And since its velocity is unchanged, time taken by the molecule between successive collision is 2L by U1. Okay? Equal to 2L by U1. Have all of you understood this part? Hence, rate of change of momentum in x direction equal to minus 2mu1, this is the change in momentum by time interval, 2L by u1 equal to minus mu1 square by L. Okay, this is the force exerted on the molecule in x direction. Is this the force exerted on wall or on the molecule? You have got minus mu1 square by L, rate of change of momentum of molecule. Is this the force exerted on wall or on the molecule? Have you calculated the rate of change of momentum of wall? Then how do you tell that this is the force exerted on wall? If you calculate the rate of change of momentum of A, then you will get the force exerted on A. This point has to be understood. If you calculate the rate of change of momentum of B, then you will get the force exerted on B. If you calculate the rate of change of momentum of C, then you will get the force exerted on C. Now here you have calculated the rate of change of momentum of molecule. So you have got the force exerted on molecule. So hence, the force exerted on the molecule in x direction equal to minus m u1 square by L. But we are interested in finding the force exerted on wall. So what is the force exerted on wall? Hence, we'll apply Newton's third law. If the force exerted on the molecule is this much, force exerted on the wall is minus of this. Hence, force exerted by a force exerted on the wall, on the right wall equal to mu1 square by L. This is the force exerted by one. This is the force exerted by one molecule. Okay, force exerted on the right wall by one molecule. By one molecule, this is the force exerted. So, what is the total force exerted on the right wall? Hence, force exerted on the right wall by all molecules. Force exerted on the right wall by all molecules equal to mu1 square by L plus mu2 square by L, mu3 square by L plus mun square by L. Okay? Hence, equal to m by L u1 square plus u2 square plus u1 square. This is fx. Is this point clear? One molecule is exerting, first molecule is exerting mu1 square by L force. Second molecule is exerting mu2 square by L force. The third molecule is exerting mu3 square by L force. So what is the total force exerted on the right wall?
Summation.
Because all the forces are in same direction. Now what will you find? Now we can find the pressure exerted in x direction. Okay? Because we know that pressure equal to force by area. So hence, pressure exerted in x direction. Pressure exerted in x direction, Px equal to Fx by L square. What is the area of the right wall? Area of the right wall is L square. So what is the pressure exerted in x direction?
Fx
by L square equal to m by L cube into u1 square plus u2 square plus un square. Okay? This is Px. So, similarly, we can write Py, pressure in y direction, what will you write? What are the velocities in y direction?
V1, V2, V3.
Okay? So that means m by L cube, V1 square plus V2 square plus Vn square. And Pz equal to?
m by l
cube. P is 8. M by l cube, w1 square plus w2 square plus w3 square plus wn square.
How will you get the pressure of the gas? Average. Very good. Average. We'll use a fact that pressure of a liquid at a point or pressure of a gas at a point is same in all directions. Do you remember this? You studied in class 9 level that at a point inside a liquid the pressure has same value in all directions. In this direction the pressure, in this direction the pressure, in downward direction, in this direction. At a point inside a liquid, pressure has same value in all directions. Okay? So, using that fact, we can write that Px equal to Py equal to Pz. Okay? So, gas exerts pressure, same pressure in all directions. That means Px equal to Py equal to Pz. Or, the pressure of the gas P equal to average of these three. Px plus Py plus Pz by 3. Okay, so write, since a gas exerts same pressure in all directions, a gas exerts same pressure in all directions. Hence, Px equal to Py equal to Pz. Or P equal to pressure of the gas P. Pressure of the gas P equal to Px plus Py plus Pz by 3. Okay? So we are close to getting the answer. Equal to M by 3L cube. U1 square plus V1 square plus W1 square. U1 square plus V1 square plus W1 square plus U2 square plus V2 square plus W2 square. U2 square plus V2 square plus W2 square. Okay? Plus U3 square plus V3 square plus W3 square. Okay? But what is U1 square plus B1 square plus W1 square? C1 square. What is U2 square plus B2 square plus W2 square? C2 square. Hence, this is equal to M by 3L cube. C1 square okay. Equal to M. Now C1 square plus C2 square plus C3 square plus Cn square we'll write this, we'll convert it into RMS speed square. All of you know RMS speed, root mean square speed, root mean square speed, C1 square plus C2 square plus C3 square by n, C1 square plus C2 square plus C3 square plus Cn square by n whole root. RMS. Root mean square. What is root mean square speed? See,
Suppose these are the numbers. You have to find the RMS value. Root, mean, square. That means first you will find mean of the squares. Mean, average of the squares. Then root of that. Average of the squares, root of that. Root, mean, square. So how will you find the RMS value for these four figures? First find
average
of the squares. Average of the squares. So 1 square plus 2 square plus 3 square plus 4 square divided by 4. Mean square. This is mean square. Means mean of the squares. Root of this is called RMS. Root mean square value. Okay. So that means 1 square plus 2 square plus 3 square plus 4 square by 4, it is equal to RMS square. 1 square plus 2 square plus 3 square plus 4 square by 4 equal to RMS square. So here we are having C1 square plus C2 square plus C3 square plus CN square. We'll divide this by N because there are N number of terms, capital N. There are N number of terms. So this will be divided by N. Then to cancel that N, we'll multiply it by N. Divide by N, multiply by N. Then this term will be square of RMS velocity. Okay. So this is equal to M multiply by N divide. Three L cube, C N square divided by N. Okay, this is equal to or P equal to M N by 3L cube into C square. Okay, C is the RMS speed. Now what is L cube? Volume. M into N, what is M into N?
Total mass.
Mass of one molecule is M and there are N number of molecules. Capital N denotes total number of molecules. Small n denotes number of molecules per unit volume. So total mass by 3 into total volume into C square equal to what is total mass by total volume?
Density.
So this is the expression. What exactly is this kinetic energy? It depends on what?
Temperature.
So this is actually what? Correct. This is the internal energy. When we discussed internal energy, we discussed that total internal energy equal to total energy of its molecules. Total energy of molecules means potential energy plus kinetic energy. Then potential energy is zero, so it is equal to kinetic energy. And there I told that kinetic energy depends on temperature only. So that's why internal energy is a function of temperature. Now you can see it yourself that kinetic energy actually depends on temperature. Okay, so this is actually the internal energy. Kinetic energy of one molecule. Okay, one molecule. So kinetic energy depends on temperature. Okay, that means internal energy of a gas depends on its temperature. Because internal energy means total kinetic energy. Okay. Find an expression for the RMS speed. Of the molecule of an ideal gas find an expression for the RMS speed of the molecule of an ideal gas in terms of its temperature. Use this. P equal to 1 by 3 rho c square.
C square equal to
3p by rho
or C equal to root over 3p by rho.
What is the question? Get RMS speed in terms of temperature. So now we'll go for replacement of P
equal to root over P equal to A naught T by V. C equal to root over 3 A naught T by rho V. This is equal to 3 A naught T by rho into V is total mass.
Total mass will be written as number of moles into molecular weight.
Number of moles is N, molecular weight is M.
Capital M. Molecular weight is
capital M. N and cancel.
So we get a very important formula. C equal to this RMS speed.
Root over 3 RT by M.
Okay. T is the temperature and M is the molecular weight. What is the molecular weight of oxygen? Suppose I have given you a problem. I have stated the temperature to be 27 degrees centigrade and I have asked you to calculate the RMS speed of the molecule of oxygen. What will you put in place of M? 32 what? Just 32? M equal to? 32? 32 grams. So remember, in place of M, you will not put 32. You will write 32 into 10 to the power minus 3. You got the point? Students write M equal to 32 and they get wrong answer. It is 32 gram. 32 gram. And you are doing your calculation in SI. R is 25 by 3 in SI. So what will you write in place of M for oxygen? 32 into 10 to the minus 3. For nitrogen? 28 into 10 to the minus 3. Okay. Mean? Root over 8 RT by pi M, and most probable speed root over 2 RT. Root over 2 RT by M. So these speeds are, so there are three different speeds. Okay. All these speeds are based on
different statistical approach. Okay, because we have calculated average speed, there are different methods for finding average. Okay, using one method, we get root over 3 RT by M, which is called RMS speed. Then if you use another method, you will get root over 8 RT by pi M. This is called mean speed, mean. And using another approach, you will get most probable speed, root over 2 RT by M. Okay, so you can consider their values. Root over 2 RT by M, how much is this 8 by pi? It is 2 point something. And how much is RMS speed? Root over 3 RT by M. So that is all these values are between root over 2 RT by M and root over 3 RT by M. Okay, root over 2 RT by M and root over 3 RT by M. RMS speed
equal to root over 3 RT by M.
So you can see that mean speed is actually between RMS speed and most probable speed. It is 2 point something.